Good morning and welcome to the first meeting in 2017 of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. Can I remind everyone to switch mobile phones and other devices to silent as they may interfere with the broadcasting. Our first agenda item today is a decision to take agenda item 4 in private. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. And our second item today is proposed cross-party groups. And we'll take evidence from the proposed groups this morning. The first one is the proposed cross-party group on Brexit. I welcome Tavish Scott, MSP, this morning. Tavish is the proposed deputy convener of the group, and I'd invite you to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, convener. The intention of our group is to create, above all, a forum for debate and lively interpretation of the ongoing political issue which is going to govern our lives, I suspect, for the remainder of this Parliament. And the strength of our proposal, I hope, for your committee is that not only is it cross-party, but it also governs both sides of those who argued and voted on this matter as well. And that, I think, is both helpful and constructive. And what we want to do with our group is just make sure that out with the formal structures of parliamentary committees, both in this place but also down at Westminster, there is a genuine forum to bring together people who maybe haven't had their view heard before. And we're going to do that in a variety of different ways, subject, of course, to your committee approving the formation of our cross-party group. Just for the avoidance of doubt as well, we just haven't had enough time yet to invite and pool in external members, but we certainly plan to do that as well. So that will be very much part of our plans for the future.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I invite any questions from the committee? Yes, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Kamina. Thank you, Travis. I do believe there is a real need for a group of this nature because we're moving into new territory. And as you indicate in the report, you know, it's a watchdog. And I think that is important. But my question is engagement. You know, there's a very broad church out there of individuals, organisations that you may need to try and capture. How are you planning to try and do that in a reasonable timescale? And how will you engage with them effectively?
It's a very fair question. I'm not sure we've totally worked that out yet. I suspect we'll be governed by the ability to react or to attempt to judge the process that we all believe to be underway now. And for example, we are hoping to bring to Edinburgh, and we're not wedded on just having this in Edinburgh either, but bring to Edinburgh a number of speakers from different aspects of not only Scottish life, but also international life as well. I think the four of us who get together, if you see any conspiracy, it's 8 o'clock on a Wednesday morning when we're having breakfast together. That's when all the power things are decided. But so if you want to intervene in that, please feel welcome to come along. But the serious point is that by bringing people from out with mm-hmm. Scotland who bring an international perspective to a meeting or to a discussion hosted by an independent chairperson of some description, which is how we plan to develop this, we hope to capture that very point.
I mean, we've had some of the breakfast briefings that Spice have put together recently when they've been discussing the Brexit issues, and they've been extremely well attended, which is very encouraging.
Exactly.
And I do think that you will get a good turnout at all your meetings as well.
Yeah. No, I think that's, well, thank you. I think that's fair. And I also think there's an onus on us to raise the bar a bit. I mean, we all sit around many committee tables, and it is what it is, as Daniel Johnson and I would be reflecting on education yesterday. But we've got a job to do in terms of bringing a calibre of person to a meeting, which we hope will provide interest not only for elected members but also for a wider audience. And believe me, we cross the divide in terms, well, I shouldn't call it a divide, that's a very pejorative term, but we cross the Brexit debate in terms of those who believe for and those who are Remainers. So we'll keep it that way too.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I bring us Mr. Harvey?
Thanks very much. Good morning.
Morning.
Two questions. One is on the first of the three bullet points on the group's purpose to act as a watchdog over the Brexit process. And I wonder if you could just say how you feel that will connect or relate to the committee's responsibility, how they overlap and what the balance of activities will be there. The second question is on the third point. To make contact with other European countries and institutions to examine the best way forward for Scotland and the UK post-Brexit. Now, I recognise and value the fact that you've said that there are people who voted and campaigned for yes and no within that, but I wonder whether there's an implication in point three, and whether it's a deliberate implication that the group is restricted to those who accept that Brexit is happening and that Scotland's going along with that. How do you intend to relate to or reflect the views of those who don't accept that Scotland should be taken out of the European Union?
Yeah, very fair question, Mr. Harvey. I think it's a subtle point, the third one, rather than a hard point. Hard, soft Brexit, this is a soft point rather than a hard point. I wouldn't overinterpret it, because for those of us who campaigned for Scotland and the United Kingdom to remain within the EU, we're never going to allow that to become a hard interpretation of how our cross-party group would operate. So our view would very strongly be to make sure that, again, we cover, as I answered before, we cover both aspects of what could happen in the future, and I think that's very important. So is that sloppily worded? Yes. Could it have been worded a little more, less pejoratively? Yes. On your first point, in no way would we seek to cut across a parliamentary committee. We won't have the resources to do it anyway. I have just sat upstairs going through 108 pages of Stephen Imrie's latest epistle on Brexit and all that it means to Scotland. And it's very good. It's very, as you'd expect with Stephen Imrie, it's extremely well written. And we simply won't have the resources, never mind the secretariat, to do that. So as Alec Neil and I have slightly observed, watchdog may be slightly too strong a word again. Probably more Labrador than Rottweiler on that one.
Thank you. Can I bring in Miss Hawkey?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Tavish, for bringing this to us today. I wanted to ask about the proposed membership of the group. You were saying you had you were short of time before this was submitted, which was the 30th of November, I note. So we've now had a month and a half since then. So have you explored who you would be inviting to be non-MSP members of the group, and perhaps you could explain how you're going to source that membership?
We haven't, for the simple reason that we thought until the cross-party group was set up, there wasn't a lot of point in all of us in pushing that any further. But once, subject, of course, to your agreement, once we're underway, we will have an open invitation on this matter to wider organisations and groups. We're also seeking, as with most cross-party groups, to establish a secretariat that I would be quite open about has not been as straightforward as we would have liked. And it's just tricky to get the right kind of organisation who would service this group. But once we do that as well, we'll have some, as it were, administrative firepower as well as, we hope, some intellectual firepower. So there are no caveats on that in terms of who could be a member, and we'll be very open. Indeed, we would be happy to furnish the committee with a letter indicating how we plan to proceed on that subject, of course, to your agreement.
Yeah. And so as a follow-on from that, because I was going to ask about secretariat, but you're talking about bringing international speakers
to
the group. Mm-hmm. There's no indication of how that would be financed on your application.
No, indeed, and when we need to, that's where our secretariat is important, because we hope to have an organisation who will see the benefits of exactly that, of frankly paying the travel expenses of bringing people to Edinburgh to create the debate and to allow the debate to happen. And we, as you all know, we can't do that out of thin air, so we need to do that. But again, we'll be happy to write to you with that detail.
Thank you.
Yeah, can I bring Mr. Scott and then Mr.
Do you have a secretariat in mind?
Well, we do, but if you'll forgive me, Mr. Scott, I'm not at liberty to say who it is, because, as the Minister would say, if I was a Minister, discussions are at an advanced stage. I'll be happy to... you remember how I used to do this when I was a Minister. Discussions are at an advanced stage. We'll be happy to provide details when we can. But yes, discussions are underway.
Mm-hmm. And how do you propose to contribute to the Brexit process here in Scotland? How do you feeding in to whom, or are you just going to be at a forum and that's it, or is there going to be another sense of purpose for the group?
I think the view of the four of us who've got together to discuss that is that the best role we can play is to be a forum. I mean, the debate at times has been too low. The debate hasn't been deep enough, although I think the European Committee has done Stephen Imrie's report, which you'll see published in a few weeks' time, is very strong on analysis. But again, we're getting, in effect, I think I'm going to call it a running commentary coming out of governments all over Europe at the moment. We want to just be part of that and make sure there's a very clear focus on Scotland, but make sure there's a different perspective on Scotland as well. So we hope to bring people in who provide that different perspective and create a genuine forum where colleagues from right across politics and people from out with politics can think about it and question it. This is probably the biggest decision, or you know, it's the biggest set of circumstances we're all going to have to deal with in our lives, and we hope to add a little bit to that.
Okay, Mr. Johnson.
So, I mean, both as a declaration of interest in terms of context for my question. I mean, as you are aware, I've held a few discussions looking at the possibility of setting a cross-party group on Europe, the purpose of which would be to look more broadly about the interaction between Scotland and Europe beyond the EU, and also looking at social and cultural elements of Europe and sort of European institutions beyond the EU. Do you think this would be overlap? But do you think those two groups could coexist, or do you think that would be problematic to have two groups coexisting if the CPG in Europe were to be proposed?
I wouldn't wish to prejudge where you'd wish to take that, Mr. Johnson, although that strikes me as a very wide remit. I think ours is going to be, if I may say so, pretty strong around politics. The people we want to have come and create the forum and the discussion are going to be broadly in the political sphere, although they're going to come from industry, they're going to come from different backgrounds as well. But they're still going to be, after all, talking about the ongoing political process that is going to be what we're all going to go through for the next number of years. And I think that's where our focus is going to be. If your group and your much wider and therefore probably much more long-term constructive approach is around the future of the arts, the future of culture, the much wider perspective on Europe, I don't think that's by definition, a good thing to do. I think ours is going to be pretty strong on the politics of what we're all dealing with, and we hope to bring some interesting people to engage in that.
Can I also just, you mentioned that there'd been some issues around finding a secretariat. I mean, are those issues sort of potentially relevant and worth drawing to the attention of the committee?
Well, again, we'd be happy to write to the committee or to the clerks once we've got that ironed out. All cross-party groups are challenged by the need to have a secretariat, depending on what the scale of activities they want to undertake. I was at the Tibet cross-party group last night, which operates on a very very small and dedicated group of people who just do it because they love it and because they care passionately about it. That's different from bringing people into Edinburgh in order to create the kind of forums we want. And we've got to create some money to do that in order that people can that we can pay travel expenses. So that's simply the process we're going through at the moment.
Thank you. Any further questions from the committee members? Could I just ask, obviously we have a number of CPGs established in the Parliament, many of whom will be considering the impacts of Brexit on their particular area of interest. Have you thought about how your CPG might interact with other CPGs in the Parliament so that there's not a duplication of effort maybe working joint meetings with other committees?
It's a very fair point, Convener. Short answer is no, we hadn't considered that, but we'd be happy to do that and happy to make sure that we achieve the objective you've just pointed out.
Okay. We will be considering your application agenda item 3, and you'll be informed of our decision as quickly as possible. Can I just say, as a matter for all CPGs, that the secretariat is a decision made by the CPG members once they're established autonomously, and that the secretariat would normally be a member of a CPG, and also that when new members do come on board, that the clerks should be informed within 30 days of that process. And that's just a timely reminder for all CPGs. So can I thank Mr. Scott for his attendance this morning, and I'm sure our decision will be conveyed to you as quickly as possible.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I suspend just shortly while we change witnesses? Thank you. Okay. Thank you. The second group for the committee's consideration is a proposed CPG on improving Scotland's health, 2021 and beyond. And I would like to welcome Kenneth Gibson, MSP, who is the proposed co-convener of the group, to the committee this morning, and invite Mr. Gibson to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, convener. I wasn't really going to say much. I think it's, you know, as they say, you know, basically it's all there on the side of the tin, so to speak. I mean, the purpose of Improving Scotland's Health 2021 is primarily to look at how we can, as it says, try and improve people's health, particularly in the areas of reducing tobacco usage, alcohol misuse, and also looking at the obesity epidemic. I'm delighted by the fact that it truly is a cross-party group and that all five parties represented in the Parliament have members. As you've said, there's a joint convenership between myself and Jenny Mara, and we'll alternate convenership in the meetings. We'll meet four times a year. And already we've had substantial interest from outside the Parliament. We've got some 20 organisations who've already joined the cross-party group, subject to being approved, of course. And we've also started looking at the kind of agenda that we would have over the next year. We're quite clear that we want to be, you know, we want to set goals that can be achieved and we can benchmark year by year. And of course, like other cross-party groups, we would hope to try and raise the profile of the group by not only debates in the Parliament and questions, but also we want to fully engage with the Scottish Government by having, for example, members of the health team come and present and answer our questions at various meetings. So that really is it. What I would say, of course, is that the Secretariat has been provided jointly by ASH Scotland and Alcohol Focus Scotland. And there is no membership fee for anyone to join, and I would encourage any MSPs on this committee, if it's agreed this cross-party group should be formed, to join and participate in it.
Thank you very much. Can I invite any questions from members? Yep, Mr. Harvey.
Thanks very much. I think it's a very interesting group. The particular issues that you propose to focus on, health harm caused by alcohol, tobacco, poor diet and obesity, predominantly focus on areas where there are commercial vested interests from industries. And I wonder if you're intentionally keeping it to those kind of issues rather than wider environmental or lifestyle factors where that's not so much of a barrier. And also, if that's the case, what kind of thought you've given to any kind of overlap or connection to the cross-party group on food as well?
Well, we've not put any barriers up in terms of the group. You know, initially it was about what we wanted to achieve. I mean, I certainly believe that there'd be room for cooperation with other cross-party groups. As convener of the cross-party group on epilepsy, for example, we've had joint meetings in the last Parliament with the cross-party group on mental health, so I'd be quite happy to engage with all sorts of organisations. One thing we've been very strict about is membership restrictions in terms of the tobacco industry and lobbyists for the tobacco industry. We're having a discussion at our next meeting about our view on alcohol. Mm-hmm. I mean, I personally, for example, am against the Scottish Whisky Association being associated with the group for its because of its obvious opposition to minimum unit pricing. Others may have a different view on that, but we're not there to argue for certain aspects of industry. What we're actually trying to do is to look and try and pool various organisations together to see how we can work with the Scottish Government and various organisations, the third sector and other, to try and tackle some of these huge societal impacts. And we are looking, for example, you know, social levers for change as well. So it's so that the group actually is trying to have a broad remit. In 1999, I formed the cross-party group on tobacco control. That became the cross-party group, you know, on, I'm trying to remember the exact name of it, when Willie Rennie was the convener. I convened it for 9 years, and then he took it over for 4 years. It wasn't tobacco control, it was tobacco and health, I believe. But also, we think that there's so much linkage in terms of addiction between tobacco and alcohol, for example, that it would be wise to kind of to link the two and have a more of an umbrella organisation. And that seems to have resonated with the third sector, which is why already at the first meeting we had 20 organisations who wished to participate. And just for information, they include organisations, for example, from Obesity Action Scotland to the British Heart Foundation, Macmillan Cancer Support, Scottish families affected by alcohol and drugs, and the University of Glasgow, Royal College of Physicians. So loads of different organisations from a wide spectrum are interested in participating in this group.
Yeah, I can understand exactly why you would be cautious about or hostile to the idea of tobacco industry lobbyists being mm-hmm. involved as external members, for example. There might be more controversy or mixed opinions, for example, on issues around electronic cigarettes and industry voices there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure whether that's something you would have reached a view about yet.
No, I don't think we have as yet. I think I would imagine most members would take a cautious approach to that, but I think that's not something we've really sat down and defined as yet, because it is obviously early days. We've just had the first introductory meeting, and there was a lot of discussion over a lot of issues about, and a lot of enthusiasm. And when you've got so many organisations in the room who all want to see how the group actually, you know, should develop, then I think it'll take a two or three meetings perhaps before we actually you know, set everything down in kind of tablets of stone, so to speak.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, convener. Some huge challenges, and I think you appreciate what you're taking on here. You know, it's going to be a massive potential issue for you. And, you know, education, marketing, promotion, all of that comes into this process because individuals make choices sometimes dependent on what they are perceived and the advertising and the organisations mm-hmm. and industries that you've touched on already, but how are you going to market and promote yourself to make sure that you get the right people from these organisations in, and also if you are going to exclude any other or some organisations because you feel that they are creating the problem, how are you going to manage that? Because there could well be a conflict.
Well, first of all, what I would say is that the decision on who to exclude or indeed include is really a matter for the wider group, and where possible, I think we'll try and take those decisions on a consensual basis. Mm-hmm. In terms of marketing the group itself, you know, there's a whole. It would really depend on what the group is actually trying to do. I mean, obviously, you know, social media, press within the Parliament mm-hmm. itself, direct contact with MSPs and other organisations. I think though there's a kind of network out there of organisations that are involved in these particular areas. I mean, a lot of them are interconnected already, and so I think that you know that there is a kind of Bush Telegraph which helps market it. In terms of dealing with you know, some of the some of the issues such as tobacco, I mean, the cross-party group on tobacco control was very much involved in doing work, for example, in terms of in the lead up to the driving force for the smoking ban. It was a group that actually put that into the public domain. We had discussions with ministers, people like Bill Aitken from your own party, Robert Brown for the Liberal Democrats, for example, Richard Simpson from the Labour Party were all very influential in actually taking that agenda forward then. And I think it shows that cross-party groups can actually be effective in terms of raising ministerial and public awareness of some of these issues. I mean, I think, to be honest, there is huge awareness of some of these issues, but there's also a concern, certainly among members of our group, that people think, well, since the smoking ban, tobacco is no real an issue anymore. Well, it still kills thousands of people every year in Scotland, and so we want to ensure that it doesn't fall off the agenda. I don't think we would quite support President Putin's view that everyone born from the year 2015 onwards should automatically be banned from ever smoking a cigarette, which apparently is something he's talking about. But certainly persuasion, education, over a period of time, I think will be more effective.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you, Mr. Scott.
Mr. Gibson's point there, not being overly prescriptive. You say you're going to exclude lobbyists from the whisky industry, for example.
No, I've not said that. That's my personal view. That the group hasn't taken a view on that, for example, as yet. That we're still to discuss the position with regard to alcohol companies, for example, the Portland group. Should it be included? Should it not? The only groups we've decided should be banned at this stage are really the tobacco companies and those that serve their interests. But in terms of alcohol, I think a more nuanced approach is likely to be taken by the group in that regard.
Food industry, my question is, where do you stop and start when you decide to ban one group of people from a cross-party group, which is about a forum for discussion?
Uh-huh.
In the interest of fairness, I would like to think that all voices can be heard. Or perhaps that's not your intention.
Well, I think that is, as I say, is a matter still to decide on, to be honest. I mean, you know, because obviously if we're going to be talking about obesity, you know, is there an argument, you know, that, you know, a chocolate manufacturer would be banned? You know, would that be the case or would it not be? I think to be honest, as I said, we will take a more nuanced approach with these, you know, organisations. We all have different views, and I think we'll come to consensus, but tobacco is the only industry that we've decided would not be in any way connected to the cross-party group at this stage.
Right, thank you.
Okay. Mr. Johnson.
First of all, I mean, I think the aims and purpose of the group are laudable and I think valuable within the Parliament. I just got a question really about the title of the group is the Cross-Party Group on Improving Scotland's Health, but the both in terms of where this group has come from and the details of the group is very focused on alcohol and tobacco. I'm just wondering whether or not that the intention is to remain focused on those two issues or whether or not there's a wider preventative health agenda that you're wanting to look at more broadly and whether or not in the future that might be reflected in your aims?
Well, I think that's a very good question, and I think in actual fact the answer bluntly is yes. We are looking more at a preventative health agenda. We are looking at trying to encourage people in Scotland to lead healthier lifestyles in terms of what they eat and hopefully to drink and smoke a bit less. So I think that's definitely what we would do. I think what we want to do is try and not kind of encompass everything at the early stages of the group. But what we've said, the reason we've set the kind of title that we actually have done is to say, this isn't just something for now. What we want to do is to look, okay, 2021 and beyond, it's because during this parliamentary term we want to be able to have some achievements, but we want to make it clear this is a long-term issue. We want people 20, 30 years from now to be much healthier than people today, live longer but also live healthier. So it is about lifestyle, it is about environment, as Patrick Harvey talked about. It's about all these issues really, and it's about how we draw them together and how we focus to take things forward. And that's really about taking ideas from all the constituent organisations within the group and also from the MSPs in the group to narrow that down and set ourselves achievable goals so that we can, a year from now, we can sit around and say, what would we do in the last year that actually made any difference?
Ms. Hawkey?
Thank you, convener. Thank you very much for bringing this. I think it's certainly sounds like a really interesting cross-party group. I've got two very brief questions.
Sure.
The first one is about the organisations who have already signed up.
Yes.
I see you have three medical associations there. You've got the BMA and two Royal Colleges, so one a physicians, one a psychiatrist.
Mm-hmm.
Have you looked to
the RCN?
Not only the RCN, but to other healthcare professionals, organisations to join the group. I don't know, has that invitation gone out to them? And also, and I declare an interest here because I'm co-convener of the Mental Health Cross Party Group,
mm-hmm.
And obviously, mental health plays a huge part in mm-hmm. in people's health, and we need to look at improving mental health across the country. How you see your group working alongside the Cross Party Group on mental health?
Well, first of all, invitations haven't out. I mean, these are just the initial organisations that have joined. I think once the organisation gets established, if it's approved, we'll obviously have other organisations, I would hope, that would certainly wish to join, and I think the RCN would certainly have a role to play in that, as would others, and indeed other third sector organisations across the board. In terms of working with other cross-party groups, and certainly I, and I'm pretty sure Jenny's co-convener and other members of the group would be more than happy to work with other cross-party groups. As I said in the last Parliament, Cross-Party Group on Epilepsy, which was chaired by myself, and Cross-Party Group on Mental Health chaired by Malcolm Chisholm, had a very, very productive joint meeting, really well attended, actually, to look at how both mental health interacts with epilepsy. So given some of the issues that we would actually want to take forward, in this cross-party group, then I would certainly think that having a joint meeting with the cross-party group on mental health would be a very positive development. I don't think it's likely to be in the next couple of meetings because we've got to find our feet, but certainly a year or two down the line, probably, well, not as long, as far away in the future as a couple of years, but certainly a few months down the line, I would certainly be happy to have a cross-party group, and I'm sure I'd be happy, as would Jenny, to discuss that with your own secretariat about how we set that up and what specific focus we would have on such a meeting. So it wouldn't be just a meeting, it would be like something with a specific agenda and an outcome that we'd be trying to achieve.
Lovely, thank you.
Any further questions? Can I thank Mr. Gibson for his attendance at committees this morning? We'll deliberate on the CPG at agenda item 3 and you'll be informed of our decision as quickly as possible.
Thank you very much, convener. Thanks, Committee.
Can I suspend while the witnesses change over? Thank you. Thank you. The final group that the committee is considering under proposed CPGs today is on nuclear disarmament, and I would welcome Bill Kidd, MSP, to committee and invite Mr. Kidd to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, convener. The cross-party group on nuclear disarmament has been a well-established group. Unfortunately, or sadly, our secretary, actually performed all the roles of the secretariat, passed away near the end of last year. And things sort of from that side, not from the operational side, because you can't stop nuclear disarmers from talking, but they didn't put their work together well enough to actually get here sharpish prior to the start of the new year. But the whole idea behind the group is to act as a policy forum for discussion and updating on how policy impacts on nuclear issues, nuclear weapons issues in Scotland. It's the idea behind it is to share information, expertise in nuclear issues in Scotland between MSPs and the general public, as well as organisations such as Scottish CND, WILPF, that's the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, established in 1917, I'm always told, whenever anyone from WILPF is around. And other organisations who also have an interest in ensuring that the issue of nuclear weapons, both in Scotland, in fact in Scotland, in the UK and worldwide, are concerned. So that's the basis of the idea behind the cross-party group.
Thank you very much. Can I invite any questions from the committee members? Mr. Harvey?
Obviously, as someone who's involved in this, CPG members should be aware of that. I wanted just to take this opportunity to put on the record very sincere respect for the work of John Ainslie over many years in keeping the group on track and working well. The only comment I had about the paper was that you've spelled Andy Whiteman's name wrong, so hopefully that can be corrected pretty easily.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, Mr. Harvey. Either we will correct that or Mr. Whiteman may care to change his name. thank you very much. And I very much reiterate the fact that John Ainslie committed himself for over 20 years to this idea and this belief. And Janet Fenton, who's now taken over and who is a member of WILPF, she's equally as capable and will fit into the role. Thank you.
Any further questions? No. Well, it just leaves me to thank you for your attendance at committee this morning. We'll be considering the CPG agenda item 3 and you'll be informed of our decision as quickly as possible. So thank you very much, Mr. Kidd.
Thank you for the group for being so nice to me. Thank you.
If we could move to agenda item 3. And it's for the committee's consideration of the CPGs. And if I consider first the proposed CPG on Brexit. Any comments from the committee?
I think it's an idea and it crosses over so many areas and will give us an opportunity to focus here. So I would be very supportive of it, convener.
Concerns, convener. I think there's lots of gaps in the information that's been provided to us. I would be minded to ask the group to come back to us with some more information before we approve the CPG.
I think we had a similar situation with the CPG a couple of weeks ago, and we approved subject to an annual review of external membership. Would the committee be happy to approve on that basis for this committee, this proposed CPG rather? Okay, you approve on that basis. Thank you. The next one is Improving Scotland's Health 2021 and Beyond. Any comments or concerns? Are we content to agree that CPG? Yeah. Thank you very much. And finally, the proposed CPG on nuclear disarmament. Any comments? No.
Top of the Andy Whiteman's name being spelled incorrectly, objective 3 is just NA, and unless I'm missing something, just...
I think they're saying that the overlaps with existing CPGs is not applicable.
Understood.
Okay, so we have content to approve. Thank you very much. And on that note, we will take agenda item 4 in private session.